Back in 1981, at the age of 6, I got my first computer, a Commodore VIC-20.
The Commodore VIC-20. Unlike games, it has a real computer keyboard.
And for storage devices, I had, well, nothing. I had essentially two ways to get information into the computer. One was by plugging in a cartridge game. These were fun, of course, but kind of expensive and I didn't have many. The other way was by typing in games from the back of books or computer magazines. Yes, that was a thing we actually did back then. So you can see these ridiculously long program listings, combine that with my 6-year-old typing skills, and I was usually looking at several hours to type one of these things into a computer. And when trying to start the game for the first time, it usually didn't work. That's because somewhere along the line I made a typo, which then meant scanning line by line and trying to find the mistake, which could easily take another hour to find, and eventually the game would work. After spending all of that time typing it in, I would play the game for 15 minutes and then be bored of it. But there was a problem. What if I wanted to play the game again? If I turned the computer off, there was no way to get the game back without typing it in all over again. So often that meant leaving the computer stuck on playing this game for days on end until I was sure I didn't want to play it anymore. But then my parents bought me something fantastic, a Commodore data set.
Now when I got my Commodore VIC-20, it came with a C2N data set or a tape drive. Now back in those days, a disk drive was a very expensive acquisition. It probably cost more than the computer itself. In fact, I want to say that it cost around $400 Australian to pick up a 1541 disk drive as part of the computer package.
So the great thing about the dataset was that if I typed in this long program, I could record it to tape. Of course, you'll need to make sure that you wind the tape past this non-magnetic header, and then make a note of the tape counter so I would know where to find that program again in the future. Now surely everyone who owned a tape drive must have been curious enough to stick the tape into a regular tape player to hear what it sounded like, and here it is. Beautiful music to my ears. Also, many games and programs were available to be purchased on tape from the store.
And this is actually one of the first original game compilations that I can ever remember. And as you can see, it comes on two cassettes. Each game fits on one side of these cassettes. So as you can see, hopefully that will focus. You've got Beachhead on side one. And basically, if you flip the side over, you've got Daley Thompson's Decathlon on the other side. And that's something that was very, very common, to have multiple games on compilations that had one game per side.
Okay, so what do I think about them? Well, audio cassette tapes as being used for microcomputer storage and retrieval and whatnot for data is something I really never used until adulthood. And of course, it was on purpose because I was wanting to go back to play with some of these computers that I never got a chance to as a kid.
I myself have never owned a computer that needed a cassette tape drive. I have a number of Apple IIs, but I just use disk drives with those, obviously. But when I was in the sixth grade, we had a complete Apple IIe setup. And for some reason, we had a cassette tape drive hooked up to it. And I really don't know why, because we had all kinds of stuff on disk.
Many of the Commodore magazines of the day, for example, Commodore User, Commodore Format, and ZAP64, actually used to incorporate cassettes on the front of the magazine as a bonus that contained either demos or full retail games to kind of sweeten the deal to buy the magazine.
The tape drive was inexpensive and it worked, but it wasn't perfect. For one thing, it was slow. Now, with the Commodore VIC-20, it only had 5K of memory. The programs were very small, so loading time was usually less than a minute. But once computers like the Commodore 64 came out with 64K of memory, programs could be much larger. Loading times could be substantial, as much as 15 minutes to load a game. The other problem, of course, was lack of random access. The computer couldn't go search for a specific file. It could only load one file at a time, and it was the job of the user to locate the file for the computer. More complicated software that required reading and writing data on the fly would simply not be possible with tape. Now, some of the business level tape drives, such as these reel-to-reel units, could actually access data randomly and quickly, but were very expensive and obviously enormous inside. Of course, robots might like that. And you'll find these reel-to-reel units in a lot of old movies and TV shows.
Is in the Spanish for brain?
Yes.
Okay, so the electrodes.
I know one when I see one.
Okay, great.
Primitive computer.
I've seen them demonstrated in museums.
Me too. If this one's like those, it'll make the devil's own noise if you start it.
I don't intend to start it.
This technology is ancient. Shall we play a game? It's from a movie that was really popular.
I saw it.
There it is. Black Betty. That mainframe is tied to every computer system in this company. And only Wally knows its secrets.
And apparently tapes will be used in the future to store brains. So, on a more serious note, there were two styles of interface for tape drives, analog or digital. The analog interface is pretty straightforward. You just take any standard tape recorder made at that time and you plug the input and the output into the computer. Apple used this interface along with the Tandy laptops and the color computer, although they required a special breakout cable. Even this old Yamaha keyboard can load and save programs to tape using an analog connection.
And so the thing with most tape recorders is that because they're really meant for audio, they had this little knob on them called a tone knob. And if you ever used a cassette tape drive back in the day, unless you had a Commodore, this tone knob kind of became the bane of your existence.
I love the fact that you can also just mess with this in ways that obviously it was never intended. So if you get certain programs, you can convert over old programs into something that maybe was on disc and put it on tape and then stick it on an MP3 player or your cell phone or something. As long as you have the cables and volume set correctly, then you can just get it to work.
So what Clint is talking about here is that the computers were only listening for sound. They really didn't care where the sound came from. It could have been, you know, a tape or a vinyl record, or it could have come over the air. They just really didn't care. The upshot of that today is that computers with cassette interfaces are super easy to get software from the internet. All you need is a simple audio cable like this. And you can open a website on your cell phone and find a game you want and then play the audio file. And of course you'll hear this sound. But if you plug that into the computer, it will think this is loading from tape, and in just a few seconds you'll have loaded up your game. On the other hand, Commodore used a digital interface on all of their computers, and this system was supposedly more reliable. It was, at minimum, simpler to connect and use since it didn't require adjusting any audio levels. Atari used a similar system with their tape drives. Since Commodore machines don't have an analog input, you would think they would not be able to take advantage of this, but for just a few bucks you could buy an analog to digital tape adapter that will allow you to have the same functionality.
There's also the fact that I heard in Europe there were some flexi discs, like they were like records, almost like vinyl, but in a flexi kind of format, really cheaply done, and some games were actually distributed on that using the same audio interface as well, so you could just put that on your record player and hook it into your audio in on your computer and get it that way. And also sending the signals over the air with radio.
A similar principle can be used to transfer software from your computer directly to a cassette recorder like this, and now you've made a cassette that you can play in your original tape drive.
So the other thing that I remember from loading games from cassette and cassette-based games was the loading screens and music. Now, while waiting for a game to load, many of the titles used to incorporate beautiful looking screen artwork and music, which made the process much less painful. For example, Ocean Software in particular spent a lot of care and attention in producing loading screen artwork and music. And games like Rambo and Green Beret come to mind that have some beautiful Martin Galway SID tunes and some fantastic full-screen Commodore 64 artwork, at least back in the day, that looked amazing. It really got you ready for the actual game itself. So many of the software development houses spent a lot of care and attention. They understood the pain when it came to loading games from cassette, and they tried to make things as painless as possible and provide you with some really cool things to look at and listen to while the game itself was loading. Tapes had no copy protection at all, so what that basically meant was if you had a cassette player or a boombox that had two tape players on it, which you could record from, you could easily copy cassettes and trade them with your friends.
So, how much actual data can you store on a cassette? Well, that's a tough question to answer because the answer varies widely depending upon what kind of computer we're talking about.
Also, tapes themselves came in various capacities, from 30 minutes to 90 minutes. Most manufacturers recommend using the C30 tapes, which is 15 minutes per side. Using one of those, some computers like the Commodore could only store 65K by default. An Apple II could store 296K, and the Tandy Color computer could store 329, and the Ataris could do 131K. And of course, if you decided to use 60-minute tapes, those numbers can double, and 90-minute tapes are even more. Now, where this really gets interesting is that if a programmer used their own load save routine, such as on a Commodore 64 with TurboTape software, that number increases a huge amount and stores considerably more than a floppy disk.
So what's really interesting is that the loading speed is also drastically increased, which means that with TurboTape software, the cassette tape now suddenly becomes competitive with the floppy disk in both speed and capacity.
Now, there were so many myths about loading games from cassette. I've heard so many stories about how it used to take 15 plus minutes for a game to load from cassette. Now, in my experience, I've never actually seen that happen. It's usually a 2 to 5 minute process, and there were so many turbo loaders or fast loaders incorporated in the majority of games that I used to play, which would make the process quite painless.
So if you were to just record a large program onto tape with a C64, it seriously would take 15 minutes or more to save, and consequently another 15 minutes every time you wanted to load it back.
But that is primarily due to the fact that the load and save routines that are built into the kernel ROM are just not very efficient.
If you take a look at this audio file, this is a recording of the game Commando. Now, this section here is formatted in the original tape format. I mean, it has to be in order for the C64 to know how to load the file. Now, this piece of code is a TurboTape fast loader. Once it is in memory, it takes over reading the rest of the file, which is stored in a much denser format. In fact, if you compare the waveforms from the loader to the game itself, you can see just how much denser it is, and you can hear the difference as well. If you see these flashing bars on the screen during loading, that's usually a sign that it is using a fast loader. By 1985, the USA had abandoned the tape drive and everyone had moved to floppy disks. Germany had gone pretty much the same way. However, Australia was still using tape drives throughout the rest of the 8-bit era, as was the UK.
The primary reason for this, as a modern vintage gamer pointed out earlier in the episode, is that the cost of the disk drives in those countries were prohibitively expensive.
The other thing is that since I've gotten on YouTube and I've gotten more active on social media, you know, I've got some British gamers that I follow, and you know, they'll either retweet or post their own stuff about the ZX Spectrum, which I also learned a little bit about just from reading Retro Gamer magazine. But you know, I see a lot, they'll post these collections of Spectrum games that are of course all on cassette tape. And I gotta say they look pretty cool. And you know, if it wasn't such a pain in the butt to get a Spectrum running here in the US, I think I'd like to get one and play around with it. It'd be cool.
I just never grew up with it and didn't have any idea that this was a thing until I looked into it. So maybe it's more interesting to me than maybe someone that grew up with it. Either way, tape decks, audio cassette interfaces are fascinating. I like them a lot.
Well, that about wraps it up for tape drives. Now stick around for the next episode where we talk about how floppy disks work.